reporting on the games you love by people who love to game. The MMO Reporter Network.
You're listening to Guild Wars Reporter on the MMO Reporter Network, brought to you by GoDaddy. Put your website to work while you play. Doghouse Systems. Choose your weapon with Doghouse Systems.
Episode of Guild Wars Reporter. This is episode 121. As always, I am joined by the lovely Allona.
Greetings, amazing Celeste.
Amazing.
Thank you.
Yeah. So this is actually kind of like 121.5 in a way.
It is a bit because we sort of kind of talked about the news while we were streaming jumping puzzles last week.
Mm-hmm.
But the audio was kind of foobar. So we had to go ahead and just scrap it instead of releasing it like we were planning on doing.
Yeah. Yeah. I can't read aloud the tweets I got or texts I got from you on that front.
Yeah, it was very not safe for work.
Expletive ridden.
Indeed. So we're kind of talking about some of the news that we talked about last week, along with the rest of the deluge that's happened with the feature patch. So Without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into what we did this week. Allona?
I did, like, a bunch of Fungeons, which, you know, like, maybe six. But that's, like, a lot for me. It was,
that is a lot.
Yeah, I think we had two nights where we did three or a couple. Hunter could probably correct me on the exact number, because he was our fearless leader, herding cats through the Fungeons.
Yeah, sure.
But they were fun. We actually did Honor of the Waves, one of the explorable paths, which I had never done any of the Honor of Waves explorable paths. So I'm pretty happy to at least have got one of them under my belt there. Did a fair bit of alting on lower level characters and also kitting out a couple of my 80s. For the alting, I'm kind of reticent to do any of my personal story stuff because I don't know how much is going to change, which we'll get into.
Right, yeah.
Later in the show. Slowly working towards getting 500 on my artificer. Slowly. So very slowly. It's so slow.
It is.
And at the 0 hour, so the night before it became September, marathoned getting Panther from the guild, all of his JPs for the monthly. And
oh my.
We tag teamed it. Well, because Panther hates jumping puzzles. A lot of people like jumping puzzles, but he really hates them. So Hunter took a few, I took a few, and I think Cal was supposed to take a few, but ended up... he took a couple, I think. I think he got a couple done. But so we would get to them, and then when we were at the end, he would come, we'd portal them up, and he'd get the jumping puzzle. So we was like, okay, come to this waypoint now. Come below me. All right. So we all took turns. Okay, I'm ready. He can come here now. And it was a really good way of getting them, especially if you are allergic to jumping puzzles.
That sounds like a plan.
Yep. I like doing them, so I don't mind doing them multiple times for people. And actually, I'm getting better. Okay, for last week when we did the jumping puzzle streaming, I thought there would be far more falling death on my part, to be perfectly honest.
I'm not sure. Well, no, I died a couple times, but that was at the Pig Iron Quarry.
Wait, yeah. Pig Iron had a little bit more falling. I did fall there, too. And then I demanded to be revived. Because
yes.
I'm just staying here. Someone has to come get me. The one in Deirdre's Steps in Mount Maelstrom, I thought for sure that was going to take, one, take a lot longer, two, be way more difficult than it was.
No, it's pretty simple.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. That's true. Romo in the chat room came out with us for the Pig Iron Corey part of the stream.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And or.
Oh, that's fun. Right, too. That is right. I've actually forgot that we did the ore jumping puzzle. Oops. Oops. Sorry, ore jumping puzzle. But that was it. That's all I did.
Well, you may have helped someone finish up their monthly. I, on the other hand, was just tootling along, you know, life. And then I remembered last night, it was like 11:45 on the 2nd of September. And I go, crap. Because I had forgotten completely about doing my monthly, mostly because I'd been editing a bajillion videos for PAX. So I do have
one of your earlier tips for Ask an Azura, Celeste? For the class, what was it?
To finish your monthlies in the first 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Life got busy.
I'm tired of your excuses, lady. No, actually, I'm not, because I'm surprised you have any fingers left from all the editing you've been doing.
Yeah, it's true.
You're in good company. Guy also forgot his monthlies. Aww.
See, I'm kind of glad. Although it's kind of more painful because I was at 3 of 4. I'm pretty sure. So,
did again. Did he not do jumping puzzles for you like the first day, or was that last month?
That was last month. Okay. That was at the beginning of August, I think.
Okay.
I don't know.
August flew by.
The past few months have just been marathon running. Yep. So it's been rough. I did manage to squeeze in a couple of key farms.
Mm-hmm. That is wise.
Trying to get as many keys as I could. I used them and opened up chests and didn't get squat. So that made me sad. But, you know, I thought I'd go ahead and make the attempt at trying to get some scraps or things to make money with.
I only did one like key that. Farm this last week. Just one.
Mm.
And I didn't get anything.
Gonna have to do a few more before the patch, and we'll talk about that in a bit. Let's go ahead and talk about when we live stream on Wednesday nights at 9:30 p.m. EST, 6:30 p.m. PST at twitch.tv/MMOReporter. You can subscribe to the audio version of the podcast on iTunes, and please remember to rate and review our show, Guild Wars Reporter, so that other people can know that, you know, we're awesome sometimes.
And that people listen to us on occasion.
And that people listen to us sometimes. We sometimes know what we're talking about.
Yeah. And we actually, when we, the last couple episodes where we said we didn't have any iTunes reviews, we actually did, but our service that like shunts them to us had a bit of a glitch. So we did not know we had some. So again, working in reverse order, we had one from August 9th from the Netherlands, which I thought was awesome. User R. Jeez. Crack. Yeah, gave us 5 stars. Says, charming hosts. Great show. There aren't many shows left anymore, but why need more? Celeste and Allona are funny, charming, and very informative. Latest news, lore bits, and all-round fun. It's succinct, but that is a great review. I'll take it. Thank you.
We also want to extend our gratitude to Martin for being awesome and contributing to our Patreon campaign. It's awesome, and it really helped us out with PAX, and we want to thank you for your continued support.
Thank you very much.
Report from Lion's Arch.
Obviously, the big news is that we're going to be having a feature pack come out on the 9th of September, which is in just a few days, next Tuesday.
So soon.
So soon. So we did talk about a few of these things during a live stream, but we do want to go ahead and like summarize at least some of the things. There's a lot to talk about. So, global guilds. Yes, you are still going to be separated by North American and European servers, but now all of the influence is shared. The guild vault is shared. So what happens is that the world that has the highest number of slots will become the guild vault, and then it'll kind of like, you'll lose the slots that are extended from other servers if they had guild vaults on there. So you get a chance to clear it out and everything. So you don't need to worry about things disappearing, but that's going to be happening.
Just out of curiosity, do you use the guild bank when you rep Mach?
Well, I don't know. Maybe I do have enough influence to have made a guild vault, but I hadn't.
You would have actually have had to make one.
Yes.
Okay. I see. I didn't know that. Alrighty. So guild mission improvements in that they are making it easier to organize. The mega server system will be extended with a reservation system that is automatically enabled whenever a guild member joins a map to do a guild mission, which will prioritize adding guild members to that map. The system, however, is limited to the number of spaces that get reserved on the map instance, so it'll be best for small and medium-sized guilds. What do you think that number means?
Under 50? I don't know.
50 seems a reasonable size, though. Sorta.
I mean, 50 people doing a guild mission seems like a lot.
Does. Yeah.
I mean, it seems like a reasonable number to know.
Yes, I think that would help our peers as well.
Probably.
Yeah.
Maybe. Yeah. If you wanted to RP with your guild in particular, you rep up with that guild and you're more than likely going to be dropped into an instance with them. So yeah. That's good.
Mm-hmm.
If you're on a map and it's starting to get kind of empty, you may get the notice that the map will be closing soon, and you need to take your purchases to the front and pay for them as soon as possible. And by doing so, by switching to a fuller map so they can close down the old one, you will get a Volunteer's Blessing, and that will increase your movement speed by 15%, karma gain by 5, and experience from kills by 10% for 10 minutes. And this will persist if you decide to change maps, but the movement speed is only in PvE. So if you wanted to take this and like go to Edge of the Mists and get a 5% karma gain, you would be able to.
Oh, would be able to, yes.
Yeah.
It's just the movement you wouldn't get.
Right.
Yeah. Language in Europe. They're making headroads into solving some of the language issues on the EU servers. Thanks to player feedback, we've decided to disable the chat filtering option by default. We had to deploy this system as a shield against harassment, but it was also impairing normal communication. As always, if you feel harassed, please use the in-game reporting tool. They're very reluctant to split people into mega server instances based solely on language because they'd have to deal with the possibility of having a very empty map. And I was actually just listening to the Guildmag podcast, and they were talking about being that they play on European servers, so they mm-hmm. have more experience with this. So it was really interesting hearing their perspective, like how they'll be on a map and you'll like see Spanish and French and German and Portuguese in the same map chat. Like,
right.
That's kind of cool, though.
It is a little bit cool.
Yeah.
A big thing that's happening for PvE is that there is no longer going to be a dungeon instance owner.
Whee!
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. If everyone leaves an instance, it'll close, but you don't have to worry about one person leaving your party and having to restart the dungeon. So,
if they were the owner.
Yeah.
One of my favorite ones is the crafting UI. The changes are that if you open recipes and subcomponent recipes, you can open them at the same time. Or rather, if you open the one, you can then open a window that will take you to the subcomponents. You can make those subcomponents go back to your main recipe without having to peck and hunt and type and find, and it's quite confusing as it is currently. I mean, it's obviously you can do it, but it's
a chore.
It's convoluted. There's the word.
Yeah.
Convoluted. So this allows you to craft the parts required for a recipe and allows for faster navigation. So yay. Awesome.
Good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
There's also changes to performance in that they have changed the way that a lot of the underlying systems are working, and it should clear up some of the issues that people have been having with low frame rates or really poor quality or just it being a serious resource hog. That should calm down quite a bit. And I'm curious to see if I'll actually get above 30 frames a second, because that would be pretty awesome.
I was running through a fairly untraveled section of Dredge Haunt, and I was getting up to 60 frames per second, which is unheard of even for me. But then today I logged into Lion's Arch. It took me a million hours to load into Lion's Arch. And then it took probably another 3 to 4 minutes before the pop-ins happened enough that I could even see my character and move.
Oh, yeah.
It was crazy. So I'm looking forward to this one, too. Like, yay!
There's been plenty of times where I've loaded into Divinities, and it's like, there's no floor. There's no floor.
Divinity is awesome for that, because you're higher up, so you can see like the tiers of, like, everyone's floating in air. Believe it or not, I'm walking on air. So, yeah. Next one is new leveling items. It's gear meant to specifically help you level your character. So, for example, if you're lucky enough to come across the canon law, you'll be able to choose between two stat combinations and receive a level 36 rare rifle with a Crichton rifle skin and stats that are a little more potent than most rifles of its level. And then they go on to say that recipes for these items are meant for advanced crafters, but we've also added versions of the weapons to monster halls across Tyria that come with a few stat combos intended for characters who are still leveling. So I know you're a little confused by this whole thingy-me-baby.
Yeah.
I'm not 100% sure how this is going to work either, to be honest, but I do think it's a good step. Like, for instance, I was just looking to upgrade the staff for my elementalist, and I noticed the experimenter staff, which you can buy as a recipe from, little Azura lady in Timberline Falls. That staff actually gives 3 stats for the level, which is, most of the times it's only 2. So I'm like, oh, that's actually a pretty good one. And you can buy it on the trading post. And it was like half a gold or something. And I'm like, well, I could just make it. So I went and got the recipe and then went on to my artificer. Is it artificer that does staffs?
I believe so.
Yeah. Or huntsman. Can't remember. Anyway, I went on the character that makes it, and I already knew the recipe. So I had to, like, oh, well, there's 154 karma that I didn't need to spend.
Oh, well. At least it was low.
Yes, that's exactly what I thought. But the stats on it are pretty good, so I'm wondering if it's more like that. If that's what they're thinking. I don't know.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Don't know. Gotta probably see that in the actual patch notes and probably play around with it for a little bit before I'm solid on it. There's also crafters' backpacks, which are these back pieces that you will be able to craft to show off the discipline that you are skilled in. And you're probably going to need old materials to upgrade it. Like, if you're at level 450 in Taylor, you're probably going to need to get some jute again so you can, craft it up to the level you're at. So,
please make home instance cloth areas. Please make home instance cloth areas. I will throw money at you.
Says, they'll guide players up from novice to adept crafting in each discipline, bring in new looks to your wardrobe, and come with a bit more combat flexibility than many players might have seen. So you're making a usable back piece with stats that gets better with your level. And I'm wondering if these stats will be selectable like the legendaries, or if it's like the Taylor one is good for light armored classes, so you'd have to be a Taylor on your light armored character.
No, I can't imagine they'd do it that way, because, I mean, there are people that do wacky stuff, like make their warrior their Taylor. And by wacky, I mean I did something similar to that, so.
Okay.
Which I'm kicking myself. No, I can't imagine that they would pigeonhole the crafting professions to professions that way.
Yeah.
And you can have up to 3 on your character if you've bought that expansion.
True.
So, yeah.
Yes.
Profession loot. More often than not, you will get loot that is pertinent to your profession. We'd rather that leveling players found things that felt like an immediate and useful upgrade or gave them a look at a new weapon and a chance to expand their skill set. And this seems like a good way to do that. And yay! Because when I was leveling up Allona, like, I was pretty heavily played one character for a very long time. I almost always got heavy and medium gear.
Like, yeah.
Please just give me light gear. I need it.
Exactly. Yeah. Your first time through.
My gear is really painfully out of date. Yes.
This really helps new players by guiding them towards the type of gear that they'll need to start focusing on. And it definitely leads to less confusion, more player retention, yada yada, PR terms, technical jargon, and ultimately money.
Really? How do you think that?
If players stick around, they end up spending more money.
Oh, okay, yes. Just inherently. Okay, gotcha.
Yes.
Gotcha.
So I think that's kind of what they're... A lot of the new player changes kind of are centered on player retention in a very amorphous sense. Like, for example, a clear sense of direction. This system simplifies the UI in the top right side of the game window, providing one clear suggested location and an arrow providing general direction to guide players to exciting content. The system will also help guide players to content areas of appropriate level difficulty, even to the next map, so they have a better idea of where to go when advancing their character.
But it kind of already does that already, doesn't it? Like, it says, like, new event happening, and you, like, hit your map, and you can see where to go. Or is this even going to be more obvious than that?
I think it's going to be even more obvious than the giant green star, you know, moving around you if you're in the same area, I guess. Mm-hmm. There's also going to be a setting in the options menu for those of us that don't need it or want to change it, because you can set it to world complete mode, so you can turn it on just to kind of head you towards things you haven't done yet.
Yeah, that would be very handy for some people. I think that person knows who they are. That person may or may not be in the chat room. Also, back to the previous one for a second, guy in 81 in the chat room was saying people are worried that if you play heavy and medium characters, you won't get enough drops of light armor to salvage for silk. And I feel your pain, but man, there needs to be more silk in the game, or like cloth in the game in general. Because
I think when they said profession loot, they specified that it was going to be 1 to 79 levels. So once you're at 80, you're more than likely going to be at the RNG levels again.
Okay, maybe. The next one was leveling as a reward. Level up notification changes, so you get the bouncy badge next to your bouncy chests, which actually sounds rude now that I say it out loud, to be honest.
Yeah. Whoopsie. That's okay. I'm the one that typed it.
You did type it. I blame you. When you reach a specific level, any system tied to that level will be presented in the form of a reward. The game will also offer to teach you how to use the new system and will show you what you'll get the next time you level up. They'll be hiding some portions of the UI for new players as well, though. So once the messages have been unlocked on one character, they'll be visible to all. Example, PvP and world versus world panel icons. And they've moved the down state to be unlocked at level 5 so that players have time to learn the basics of combat before they experience being downed. Mm-hmm. We also made the down state give you additional health early on to help make it easier to learn. I like that they gave it additional health. And at first I was like, I didn't understand how moving it was going to make it less confusing. But then I realized that I often forget that I was like a crazy avid consumer of all the Guild Wars news prior to release and knew what the down state was going into the game. So when it happened, it didn't surprise me at all. And I think especially some of the people coming into the game now-ish are coming in pretty much blind. Like, they're not necessarily doing all the, like, I had 5 years of news being filtered at me.
Right.
I think it probably is a good move, to be honest.
Most likely. Yeah. In the chat room, Dragon and Romo are saying that it does not turn off at level 80. So once you hit 80, you are still going to be getting stuff that is more pertinent to your profession. So there is the chance that there could be a shortage for you depending on what your profession is.
So hoard your silk, gird your loins.
Indeed. We've also taken some of the systems that felt needlessly complicated or obtuse and simplified them to make them more consistent. So leveling is the big way you gain new abilities.
I wish they had fleshed out what they felt was needlessly complicated or obtuse. Just out of curiosity, I wanted to know what would you consider complicated or obtuse, just because I'm curious that way.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
New skill slots for weapons will be unlocked for all weapons simultaneously as you level up. That means that if you pick up a new weapon for the first time after already unlocking multiple weapon skill slots, you'll automatically learn the skills for that weapon rather than having to learn each weapon's skills individually.
I'm actually kind of bummed about this change. It's not a huge deal. But I like the unlocking the weapons and learning what they do slowly over time. Like, oh, I just unlocked a new skill. What does it do? Oh, that's what it does. Okay. And then next time, what does that do? Oh, that's what it does. And it never felt like it took like a super long time to unlock a weapon. Again, maybe I'm coming at it from the perspective of someone who's done it for a long time as well. And maybe it doesn't make a difference. Maybe this makes it more simple. But I always liked the unlock of each weapon and the reasoning behind it. You hadn't picked up this weapon before. It's new to you.
Okay. Two words.
What?
Underwater elementalist.
Well, yeah, that I did that one too.
It wasn't very fun and it wasn't very fast, was it?
I did that with Saint. Saint and I, we had elementalists around the same level and we were like, let's go unlock our underwater skills. So that's true.
An hour and a half later.
Yeah, but you're doing it with a friend. And yes, the elementalist is the exception to the rule, I will admit.
It really is, yeah. I'm making a mountain out of a molehill here.
Yep.
Some other changes with stats. When you gain a level, you'll know you're progressing in a way that immediately benefits your character. You'll be able to experience a clear power difference in your character when you reach these milestones, rather than having tiny, hard-to-notice increments with each level.
Mm-hmm. I do think this is a good move. Because even if it's nothing you can customize, you at least get that, you know, a flashy notification of how your character's stats have improved when you do level up. Because right now, leveling feels meh, unless it's a level that gives you a trait unlock, and which is like, yay, I get to unlock more traits. So I'm like, it feels like you've done something other than, like, fist bump the air.
Yes, that's exactly what leveling is now. You do a fist bump, and you're done. You're like, yay, level!
Yeah, all right, let's go going back to killing Grawl.
Exactly. You gain rewards for leveling now, so of course we're going to be having these badges bouncing off to the side, and that will give you some of the rewards. They will not be able to retroactively give these awards to existing level 80 players, but all characters under 80 will use this system for their remaining levels between their current level and level 80.
I do like the idea of that. I think it's interesting. Again, it makes the little fist bump a little more like fist bump present.
Yeah, it's nice to have a little extra reward for leveling, because as it stands now, it's kind of like, oh, I leveled. How great. I'm closer to 80.
Mm-hmm.
So
they've made changes to the personal story, which I think is really awesome. Personal story instances unlock in chapter chunks, so the story flows better rather than broken disconnect you can get when you do one part of the story 6 months ago and then try to pick it up where you left off the next time.
Yeah.
Also, there's going to be better rewards for completing story chapters as they've reevaluated the rewards that were previously given as well. So no key farm and possibly no keys as far as we know.
Yeah, I think we're pretty much sure that key farm is done. So before Tuesday, get your key farm on, because it's probably, well, I'll revise. It's definitely going away.
I kind of feel like whenever I do make a guardian, if I ever make a human guardian, I just might call him Keyroy Farmkins out of posterity forever. you've served me well, Keyroy. This one gets to stay.
That works very well.
Yeah.
There were also some major changes to the wardrobe. So your wardrobe is now search capable. So you can type in what you're looking for. So you can, if you're looking for a set, it'll show up all the pieces for that set rather than having to go through on each individual piece and look for the right one. Outfits have been separated into a separate pane, and you can see the ones that you don't have unlocked with a preview. And in that preview pane, it will show you if it's for sale, on sale, or currently locked from being sold in the gem store.
Hmm.
So it's like, you could go in there, look at the Winter's Day outfit, and be like, oh, I like it. I really, really like it. And you're like, oh, it's locked. I have to wait until it comes back.
Yes.
But at least you've got a good idea of the look that you really would like to get.
Mm-hmm. I think that adding more previews is always a good thing, as far as I'm concerned. And showing what you're missing, I guess. so people can like make their shopping lists.
Mm-hmm.
As I would.
And they've certainly done that in spades with this patch.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you could now preview finishers in the wardrobe, and you can look at them and rotate them so you can look at them at different angles and, you know, try and decide if this is exactly the one that you want to get. Because sometimes they are a great amount of work, and most of the time they're expensive. So being able to see which one you really want in all of its wonderful llama glory, you can do.
Well, they have the audio as well, or is it just a visual preview?
I don't know.
Because if it's the audio as well, I'm just going to play the minstrel and the llama one over and over and over again.
I am not sure. I hope it has the audio now. I wasn't expecting that, but now I'm
setting unreasonable expectations.
Yes.
Miniatures are also going to be moving to the wardrobe from collections tab in your bank. The new mini section of the wardrobe allows you to convert any mini in your inventory to an account unlock. And so, as I suspected, prices for minis have skyrocketed.
Yep.
I had a few lingering on the trading post that sold before I was able to get home to pull them.
Oh no.
I was sitting at work reading the minis are now going to be account. I'm like, crap. I got some on the trading post that have been there for like a couple months.
Oh no.
They're not going to be there when I get back because I wanted to yank them down. And they were already sold. And yay, I got money for them. But they are now selling for twice than what I had listed them for.
Oh.
Twice!
That's painful.
Yes. So miniatures are now through your hero panel instead of your bank. And lastly, a full list of available locked minis you might want to preview can be found below your account list. There are a few minis that remain hidden until unlocked, so we still keep a bit of a mystery in the world. Clicking on any mini, locked or unlocked, shows it next to your character in the right-hand side, and you can rotate and preview the mini, seeing detail and size easier than ever before. Best of all, any mini can now be previewed from the trading post inventory and chat links. And as Live Spartan is saying in the chat room, minis won't go away after you move to another map. So,
which is awesome.
Yep. So I was like, this is like not 100% the same, but like dedicated and undedicated minis in Guild Wars 1.
Yeah.
So if people don't know, in Guild Wars 1 for the Hall of Monuments, they always had minis, but then you could put your miniatures into one area of your Hall of Monuments, and you got points for it that could be used in Guild Wars 2. And what happened with the economy was dedicated minis, you could still sell them to other characters, but they could not put them in their Hall of Monuments. So undedicated minis sold for quite a lot of money. And only a few dedicated minis sold for a lot, like Kunavang, undedicated, or dedicated always sold for a lot of money and stuff like that. But, you know, so I can't help from being partially responsible for this change, though, since we talked about our sneaky.
Yeah, our little swap meet.
Our little miniature swap meet. But I noticed there are a lot of people doing it on Reddit right now, too. Like, they're like, we'll meet up for minis exchange.
Yeah, so it's become a popular thing to do with those crazy kids.
Mm-hmm.
So now we come to the part of the show where I am really happy. Because I'm kind of getting my shinies back.
I know.
All right. Collections are hidden throughout the world. This is a new achievement category called collections. They are filled with different ways that you can get them. They're all over the place. This reminds me exactly of artifacts in Rift, and going after shinies was my number one addiction in that game.
Yes.
So I am super excited.
Which is so, okay, realistically, it's so asinine that this is what we're really excited about. When you think about it, like, it's such a silly thing, but it was like, it was my number one favorite thing about Rift. It was like, oh, I see a little sparkle. Go get it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So we apologize for being way too happy about this, but it's actually really cool.
Yeah. I feel silly but happy at the same time.
Yeah, and unlike Rift, I guess some of the artifacts were found. Let me go back to Guild Wars 2. There are different ways to obtain collections. There's the automatic, which is like a basic set. It's beginner level unlocks. It's going to be there on the pane. you know, right when you start for a level one brand new player. Mm-hmm. Then there's going to be a level that is discovered, which will be visible once you collect something from that particular set.
Yep. I'm kind of thinking like lost coins. Like, would that be, you think, kind of along those lines?
Maybe, but isn't that already like a region achievement?
It is. No, but I mean like that. Like, you'd like, oh, what's it over there? Pick it up. Hey! So.
Exactly. Then there is the unlocked version of being able to obtain them, where you get it from a creature or a chest or a renowned vendor. Mm-hmm. And the example that they spoke about was a spoon box that you would get in LA so you could collect all the spoons. And all over the place, there are people buying spoons right now. Like, all of the spoons in the game right now are being bought at an insane rate.
Yes, I believe actually there are threads on Reddit that will tell you how to... Actually, Hunter tweeted about it, tweeted the link to that. And he said, I see you've played Knifey Spoony before, so, when he posted it, which made me laugh. But yes, the spoon box. Three ways to collect. There are character or account bound, using or unlocked skins through the wardrobe. I'm not sure what that means.
So you can use an item, like double click it to use it.
Mm-hmm.
It can be bound to your character or to your account.
Mm-hmm.
Or it can be an unlocked skin through the wardrobe. So if you have that skin unlocked in your wardrobe, that goes towards completing a collection.
Okay.
When you are completing a collection, it could use any or all of these methods to be completed.
Okay. Yeah, I like the combination factor of that. So it's not just all one thing.
Right. Like, there could be a collection that's like Steak and Potatoes Man. So you need to get like the fork, a steak, and potatoes, you know.
Was that an actual example, or did you make that up?
I made that up right now. I think that's definitely going the game, though.
I'm Steak and Potatoes Man. I want to eat my steak, but I need a potato.
I am betting that there is somebody named that right now as a character.
I want to make a character named Steak and Potatoes Man. He can be best friends with Keyroy Farmkins. Moving on, they've done a bit of cleanup for just tidying up some verbiage and things like that. So, for example, the deposit all collectibles option in your inventory will now read deposit all materials. And henceforth, bonus points for henceforth, any use of the terms collections and collectibles refer to item collections. So that's good. I like things being clear.
Yes, and they've also cleaned up the achievement panel. So they've kind of shuffled a few things around. So World versus World, PvP, and Activities achievements are now under the Competitive banner. Mm-hmm. Region, Boss, and Dungeons are now under a General banner. And in the last screenshot, they showed a human in her home instance bending down and opening up a chest.
Wait, maybe that's how... Maybe it's a wardrobe. Like, maybe that's where you get cloth out of.
Hmm.
Like, maybe?
It made me think of the Zunlai chests, and like, maybe yes. We'll be able to have an actual bank in your home instance for the next upgrade.
I like your idea better. No, I still want cloth in my home instance. I want both.
It's going to happen.
It has to happen.
I don't think it's going to happen.
It has. Okay, no. Listen here, Celeste. It has to happen because they have the...
Okay.
We're going to fight because they have the basic ore and they have the wood. So it stands to reason that they would also have cloth.
No, the next thing is going to be a garden.
Oh, that too. Yes, it's bank and cloth, Note says Artful. Yes, they're two great tastes that taste great. You got your bank and my cloth. You got your cloth and my bank.
Cloth and bank.
So, yeah, that's true. Garden as well. I had forgot about that one.
Yeah, because, you know, harvesting, mm-hmm, it's a thing.
Mm-hmm. All of the skill bar videos that were part of the ready-ups over the past few episodes have been compiled into a single YouTube video. So you can see all of the profession updates all in one spot that had been shown throughout at the end or in the middle of the ready-ups. So I watched them as they came out on the ready ups, mm-hmm. and the presentation was really good. It made a lot more sense to actually have them talking and showing at the same time, so you could really see what was going on. So we're not really going to go into it a whole bunch, but if you are interested in the profession changes that are going to be coming up in the next feature patch and you haven't read or seen too much about them, there is going to be a YouTube link in the show notes, or you can just go to Guild Wars 2 official YouTube channel and watch them all collected together.
Yes, because they are awesome. And honestly, I'm an extremely visual person.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing the changes and having somebody explain it to me auditorially definitely helped for me to be able to understand what's happening and why I am so freaking happy about my Ranger now.
Yes, the Ranger one was the one I was like, whoa. I actually went, whoa, at one point. Like with the quick shot?
Yes. I may have stuck both of my hands in the air and actually, like, semi-cheered.
Mm-hmm.
It's that awesome.
I called Cal into the room and said, I have to rewind. You have to see this. So.
It's really great.
Mm-hmm. There is a new CDI topic on the official forums, and they're going to talk about guilds. And it will be broken down into time box discussion sections, such as guild versus guild, guild activities, managing guilds, guild content, etc. And it should be started up by the end of this week.
Yes.
So to keep an eye on the official forums. We will have a link to it in our show notes. Presumably, they will have a link from this to the actual CDI. So you can share your calm, well-spoken, and logically defended suggestions into the discussion.
Yes. Keep in mind that those three conditions should be met before you make a post.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And Azura.
We got another email from Artful, who actually asked, is there a way to get exotic drops in the game, or is it only RNG, which means a random number generator? My luck bar is approaching 100, but I find I'm doing explorable maps on alts to get exotics rather than getting on the champ trains, and have yet to try dungeons. Any advice to be appreciated, as always. And as far as exotics, it really is basically just RNG at this point, aside from map completions, because there are some map completions that you can't actually get exotics on, except they're in ore, I think exclusively now.
Mm-hmm.
If you're really wanting to get exotics to salvage for materials or something like that, start doing some dungeons. And then spend your tokens to get the level 80 exotic light armor gear. Make sure you get the light one, because then you're going to be getting silk and ectos and whatever rune is on them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's your best choice of your best chance of getting the best amount of materials is from doing that. And if you use a Black Lion salvage kit, it's ideal. If you're using the Mystic salvage kits, it's better than doing the other ones.
I was thinking about this because it is just RNG, and I had completely forgot that you get exotics from doing explorable completion, like map completion, because it's been so long since I've done like a high level map completion, like a really long time. So I completely forgot about that one. Upping your magic find will certainly help as well, as much as possible. But yeah, it's RNG mostly.
Big time.
Yeah.
Which is unfortunate.
So for tip of the week, my tip of the week, which I didn't have one. So I copped out with key farm while the getting's good, because it's going away in a week, less than.
Yep.
But when I was still trying to figure out what I want, I reached out to M, who's often in the chat room, to see if she had any tips. And she replied back, never cross a Silvari when violets are on the line, and never start a land war in Ascalon. So, you know, also good tips, I guess.
Very good.
Yeah. Anytime you can do a bastardized quote from The Princess Bride, it's always a good day.
Yes. Sorry, I'm running through quotes in The Princess Bride in my head rather than my tip.
She's just like, we've lost Celeste. She's just like, happy place.
Yes, I'm sorry. Okay. So my tip is actually that once you hit 80, get your master traits taken care of as soon as possible. You'll want to have access to them when the class balances go live with this patch. So please, if you haven't already done them, go ahead and get them done. It's a pain. Just get it out of the way. You'll thank yourself later.
Say you're somewhere and you notice, oh, well, Karga Queen's up. And you think, well, I could go in with this character. Like, wait. I might have a character that I know that character already has the trait unlock that comes from that one. Maybe I'll take character Y in instead and unlock it on that character. So I think it's actually in some ways but encourages you to give some love to your alts that maybe you don't play as much.
Yeah.
Makes you think of them.
Tales of Tyria.
Before last week's part show where we streamed our jumping puzzles, we actually got an email. It was JadoCast, right? Sent us a link to a really awesome video of a fan-made video of a comic graphic novel type thing. It was actually deservedly featured at the end of the most recent Ready Up as well. So it's The Daring Do Adventures of Herfolge Bold Club, issue one. Hopefully I said that right.
Freaking cool.
Yes, they said episode one, so I really do hope they make more. I just the launch the Mesmer. What?
Yes.
I love that part.
It's wonderful.
Yeah, I really do hope they do more of them because it was pretty awesome.
Yeah, and the I think rotoscoping is the term for it was really good. It's very nice.
Sorry, chat room still proceeding with the
Princess Bride quotes. Yes. A brief PSA, if you are using your account through a VPN, and for those of you who use it, you will know what that means. For a virtual private network, go ahead and make sure that you are not doing Save Network Authenticator. because a hacker could theoretically get onto the same VPN that you are on and be able to log into your account like nothing.
What?
It takes away the authenticating because it has remembered this particular network. So, if you use a VPN, make sure that you're using the mobile authenticator instead of the save network version.
Okay. That's scary.
Well, I mean, like, they'd have to figure out your password and stuff like that, but figuring out the password is kind of the easy part if the authenticator's gone.
Okay. I'm still scared now, but it's a very good PSA. I'm glad you found it.
You'll be fine.
I'll be fine. I only just got an authenticator, like, a month and a bit ago, so I was fine up till then, too.
Fine. Yes. Yeah.
Wolfineer has a new video up with a world versus world montage.
I'm gonna leave it playing in the background here.
Yeah.
I was just like, oh my god, why am I not doing this all the time? Because it's like, one, two, three, they're dead. One, two, three, they're dead.
Guy was like, hey, I could actually follow what's going on here, mostly. And I was like, wow, that's really impressive. That's some great dodging.
Yeah. Like, he's just...
we're speechless. We're talking over each other.
He's really good. Or she. I'm sorry, I don't know.
They just, are really good.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. It's the dodging is the... as much as anything. And then because I was noticing they have, when you dodge, you create a mine. So the finish them, instead of going up and finishing them, they would just run up and like while still attacking them and then dodge back, leaving the mine, and the mine would finish them off. Like, bravo, sir. Or madam. Bravo.
Yes.
I really like that.
A really awesome post over on the forums by Vistiri that just kind of has snowballed into an amazing thing, is that he made up some drink recipes, if you're legally of age, for drinking fruit juice, as we often reference it.
I hadn't looked at this link yet.
There are some great mixed drinks in here, and Ruby chimed in on the thread to let people know that they had had them at the PAX party, at the restaurant that they were at, and that they had actually run out of ingredients. It was so popular. Some of the drinks were definitely a hit.
Did you read Elemental Harmony? One of the ingredients is watermelon pop rocks.
That's pretty awesome, actually.
Visitary is going to make me a drunk. These all look so good. I love that he has the experimental ooze booze in here, though. Okay, well, if you are of legal drinking age and choose to drink responsibly, these look kind of entertaining and delicious.
They look very delicious. Mm-hmm. We also want to tip our hats and wish a bon voyage to Kate Welch and Martin Kirstein, who have both recently left ArenaNet, and we'll miss you guys, and just want to say thank you for... It sounds kind of cheesy, but thank you for being in our lives.
Yeah. Even if...
Yeah. Even if it was a one-way street.
Yes.
And sounds really creepy.
Yes. I was trying to, like, should I tell her that sounds creepy? Because it sounds a little creepy. But, no, we appreciate everything that you both brought to ArenaNet and to Guild Wars 2. And all the best in the future.
Yes.
Reddit user Ascalon, which is kind of an awesome name, had a spoilers for the book for humans and their puny problems. So, sharing my disgust for humans in Guild Wars 2. So, they talk about why humans are a repugnant in Guild Wars 2 universe. And
yes,
it's a good thread. And the best, though, I don't know if it's still at the top, but someone recapped in their own words the final scene inside the Pale Tree, where all where you have to convince all the delegates to join the fight.
It's pretty amazing. It's very funny.
Ooh, scary centaurs. So, if nothing else, and we didn't actually have it in the show, but there was another one that I read the other day on Char that was a really interesting thread and had some pretty heated arguments about whether or not Char are the real villains in Guild Wars 2. I should find it and link it. I actually feel bad. Maybe we'll do that next week and put a link in. But it got heated, that one, but in a good way. Like, it was quite interesting.
We'll have to check that out. That sounds interesting.
Finally, the PC Gamer's October issue, which I can only presume Celeste owns a copy of, because I don't. She had the news and I didn't. Coming in at number 39 out of 100 is Guild Wars 2 for best games ever.
It was like a top 100 PC games. They described it as, these are the games you absolutely need to play today. It's as simple as that.
Yep. I don't think they'd get any argument from us.
Yeah.
I might actually pick up that issue just to get the list. Be interested in it.
They had some really good ones on the list, actually.
You would hope.
No, but I mean, like, games that I've played and know are good. How's that?
You agree with their assessments?
Yes.
Okay.
If you have a community event that you would like to share with us, send us an email. We'd be able to promote it, mm-hmm. hopefully.
Hopefully. Or if you've got a burning question for our Ask an Azura segment, let us know. And yeah, we like getting emails and tweets.
Yep.
Possibly courier pigeons. We talked about that before. So courier pigeons are definitely in the roster of what we accept.
Yeah, or I guess video of your semaphore.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, but then I'd have to learn semaphore to be able to read it. Ooh, challenge. I want someone to send us an Ask an Azura in New Crichton.
Oh, gosh.
I'll translate it, Celeste.
Oh, okay.
There's an app for that.
Oh, God. Okay. Just had to throw that in there. So I got an awesome mail from Le Requiem saying, "Hi, Magical Celeste. As two of the many happy earholes, I just want to say that the podcast is awesome and we enjoyed it quite much. Please take these tokens of appreciation for all the works you and Allona have done. Thanks. Selly Cookie." And I got a superior sigil of celerity, a celebratory steak, a celery die, a satchel of celestial emblazoned armor, and chocolate cookies.
Oh, you got celestial emblazoned. That's actually really awesome.
I already know the recipe, though.
Oh.
So, I mean, it's nice.
Yeah. I was actually wondering if you would have got celestial dye. Because that would be like,
I don't think they like me that much.
It's like, I got the spearmint dye, so I'm like,
I got a celery dye.
Oh, that's right there, celery dye. And my email, which I was actually playing with guildies at the time when it came through, and I was like, oh my god, you guys, I just got the best email, or mail in game. So mine says, "Reporter Pear, hi Allona, just want to say that your podcast is amazing, and I really enjoyed it. Needless to say, the earholes enjoyed the treatment as well. Ha! Exclamation point. Hope the following pears find you well. P.S. Can you believe pear is actually a count bound? Outrageous! Though it probably makes them rare goodies. Smiley face. I thank you for the message and the amazing treats of ginger pear tart, asparagus spear, pearl, spear gun, and spearmint dye." I always feel like I should say that pearl, spare gun, and spearmint dye. Just to keep the pear theme going. But that was just super clever.
Very much.
And as much as I love everything in there, I cannot ever remove this from my mail. Ever.
I'm keeping the mail, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm. So, yay. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. So now's the time where we go ahead and talk about our sponsor. Our first sponsor is GoDaddy. If you use the coupon code MMO199, you will get a domain for yourself, whatever use you want to use it for, mm-hmm. for $1.99, which is pretty awesome.
$1.99?
Yes, $1.99 for a domain.
And is that good for like 1 year?
Yes.
Okay. See, this is, I'm such a noob with websites. I have no idea. It's
like, that's a whole year to have that particular domain for only $1.99. Super cheap.
That is a fantastic coupon code. The other thing that we have is Doghouse Systems. If you use the coupon code MMOReporter at doghousesystems.com, they will double your RAM on a new PC or laptop. Double for free. Well, for the price of one, you get the other half free.
Right. It's kind of a buy one, get one in a way. So I guess it that is, works.
It's a Rambogo.
Yes.
Which I want to make a character called that now. Rambogo.
So, Allona, if people want to get in contact with us, what are some of the many ways that they could do so?
They can email us at gwreporter@mmoreporter.com. Our Twitter is at gwreporter. Our website is guildwarsreporter.com. Voicemail is 616-666-6778, or you can use the widget on the right-hand side of the website. Our YouTube is MMO Reporter Network, and remember to like our videos and subscribe to the GW Reporter playlist.
There are tons and tons and tons and tons and tons of videos that are coming out from our PAX coverage, so if you're interested in other games at all, if you're thinking about checking out other games, because we've got a whole bunch of stuff that's kind of like new to us, so please go and check them out. We've worked really hard on it, and we want to be able to share basically what is the PAX experience as best we can, so go check it out. It's fun.
Facebook is GW Reporter, Tumblr, gwreporter.tumblr.com, or you can visit us individually on Twitter. I am at OneBigPair.
And I am at Selyuki.
And I am onebigpair.1249 in game. And I just love getting whispers from people. I had someone from Australia say hi, which was super cool. And, you know, just, it's really nice getting feedback and hearing from people who listen to the podcast who really like it. That's always awesome. And yeah, thanks. It means a lot.
Yeah, I'm Selyuki.5046, and it seems like anytime somebody whispers me, they're like, oh, I got your name from the show, and I'm like, you're not bothering me, don't worry about it, just talk.
Yeah,
we'll chat, it's cool. I'm not busy.
I am not the fastest typer, so sometimes I have to like make sure I don't multitask the typing and the playing of the game well, so I might have to like pull off to the side to be able to reply, but I do try to reply as quickly as possible. So thank you.
Yeah, we love hearing from you guys. So mm-hmm. Anytime. It's cool. So thank you, Allona, for spending time with me again this week.
Thank you, Celeste, for spending time with me.
Aw. Thank you, chat room, for being so awesome and quoting a billion Princess Bride quotes at us.
Yeah.
Being the wonderful people that you are, we really appreciate it.
Yep. Thanks for coming out, guys.
Thank you for downloading the show if you're listening to this later on. We really appreciate you guys coming back and listening to us each week. But most importantly, we hope to see you in game. Let's go head to head. Let's go head to head to head to head to head to head.
The smoothest of segues.
Yes. Hi, my button got stuck. Okay.
Don't leave me, Celeste. I can't do this on my own.